Hello and welcome. Thank you for joining us. Welcome from me, Michael Scott, who happened to be in France today, and from my joint convener, Sanford J. Ungar in Washington, D.C., to the 33rd jointly promoted event between the Future of the Humanities Project and the Free Speech Project. The latter is sponsored by Georgetown University and the former by Georgetown's Humanities Initiative, in association with Campion Hall, Oxford, and the Las Casas Institute for Social Justice at Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. Together, the two projects consider issues concerning human dignity, rights, cultures, histories, traditions, and freedoms in a wide spectrum of educational activity, policy, expression, and aspiration. In a moment, I'll hand you over to Sandy, who is the director of the Free Speech Project. He will introduce today's distinguished guests and moderate the ensuing discussion before I return to chair the question and answer session. From the start, you can type questions to the panel by using the Q&A key at the bottom of your screen. Please use the Q&A button, not the chat button. These will come to me during the session, and I will try and put them into some logical or coherent order to put then to the panelists. I look forward to a really good discussion on a very, very important subject today. And with that, over to you, Sandy.
Thank you very much, Mike. Obviously, it's apparent to everybody that this week is the second anniversary of the American withdrawal from Afghanistan and the reconquest of the country by the Taliban. So it's a timely discussion, and we expect a very good one. Let me just very briefly introduce the panelists. You know about them already if you've tuned in, but we have Professor Akbar Ahmed, who is Ibn Khaldun Chair of Islamic Studies at American University and a fellow of the Wilson Center, has 3 decades of public service to his home country of Pakistan. Nipa Banerjee is a senior fellow and adjunct professor at the University of Ottawa in Canada. She's in Ottawa today. She's a practitioner and public policy analyst in the field of international development for more than 30 years. Dawn Chatty, who is in Oxford today, is Professor Emerita of Anthropology and Forced Migration at Oxford and has long experience in this field. And Minleeb Dahl is a research fellow on religion at Regent's Park College in Oxford and is especially interested in the issue of love and religion, and particularly Islam. We may be joined, if we can technically work it out, by the son-in-law of Professor Ahmed, Arsala Khan Hoti, who is now a member of the public service of Pakistan in the province adjoining Afghanistan, one of the provinces adjoining Afghanistan. I want to begin our discussion by talking about the rather surprising meeting that occurred recently in Qatar between American diplomats and high-ranking members of the Taliban. Did not get a lot of fanfare, a lot of notice, but what do we suspect is going on? Is the 2-year anniversary significant? Dawn Chatty, perhaps you'd like to take that first.
Okay, well, just as a reminder, I do believe that the earlier agreement in February 2000 in Doha required the Taliban or to negotiate with the government. But the two big issues were finding a way of countering terrorism and managing drug trafficking. So I suspect that this meeting was really about making, bringing the Taliban, pulling them up and saying, well, you're not really managing terrorism. You're still, providing Al-Qaeda with safe houses, and are you really controlling drug trafficking? If I, the growing of opium and that movement out of the country. And the reason why I think that's at the base of that meeting is, as you know, in the Arab world, Syria, which has been one of the main producers of Captagon, a kind of a fentanyl type drug, has been on everyone's mind in the region. And it's the agreement that was reached with Syria to try and control the export of that drug that resulted in its being readmitted into the Arab League. So I have a feeling it's about drugs, opium, you know, sort of continuing to be thrown out across the world. And also the fact that, you know, for example, Ayman al-Zawahiri was found and killed with a drone, I think it was last summer, just about a year ago, in spite of the fact that the Taliban had promised, that was part of the Doha agreement, that they wouldn't give Al-Qaeda or ISIS, you know, space in the country. So I think that it's the terrorism issue, not women's rights, not human rights, but the terrorism issue and the controlling of drugs that are at the core of that particular meeting.
Professor Ahmed, thank you very much, Don. And I think it's important to be reminded of that fact. But do you think the meeting, Professor Ahmed, in Qatar implies a sort of acceptance of Taliban in a quasi-diplomatic sense, a kind of feeling that we must talk to them, people must talk to them, and therefore that might be taken by some to endorse some of their more objectionable and heinous policies?
Implicitly, yes. At the same time, what it is also telling us is that America, the United States, is waking up to the fact that it left so abruptly 2 years ago, just abandoned the arena, literally abandoned it. You saw all those dreadful images of the planes taking off with Afghans hanging on and then falling off the planes to their deaths. And what has happened in the meantime? A great deal. A great deal has happened. For a start, China, which is now the primary concern of the United States in its global policy concerns and priorities, China has entered the Middle East very vigorously. And we saw its success in bringing Iran and Saudi Arabia to the negotiating table. It's very active in Afghanistan, which has been abandoned and left open by America's abrupt departure. And most important, for as far as I'm concerned, someone who has been dealing with this subject for decades now, that the two great factors, the features which the introduction to our session talked about, human rights and human dignity, but the two main concerns, that is the role of women and the role of the minorities who are being brutally suppressed, have been by the Taliban over the past two decades. And once again, those are more or less being ignored. And they're being ignored because the Taliban will counter this by saying, well, our money is blocked and therefore we are going to continue to really treat women in this disgraceful manner. And there's where the matter ends. So America has to come up with a much more effective policy in order to push the Afghans and the Taliban out of this frame of thinking and actually solving the problem of educating women, giving them employment, and mistreating them in this really shocking manner. Similarly, we need to remember that Afghanistan, and I want to underline this and repeat this for this conference and again at every forum, Afghanistan still remains a highly tribal society, which means by definition, and I'm an anthropologist and Dawn will appreciate this definition of tribalism, they really march to a very different drum than say a European nation or a nation like a modern nation like say Japan or even India to some extent. So they are tribal in the sense that they work on the basis of tribal loyalties, tribal alliances, tribal leadership, tribal codes of honor. And these tribal codes are very defined. They depend on hospitality, on courage, on honor, and above all, the law of revenge. These are very much in operation. And I studied tribes in Islam in a book called The Thistle and the Drone. The thistle is taken, if you remember your Tolstoy, from a short story of Tolstoy walking about in the Caucasus Mountains. And he made the observation that the tribes are like the thistle, they're very prickly. So I thought that the thistle, representing the tribes, and the drone, representing modern technology, were coming to a head and clashing in these tribal societies. And I studied 40 such societies, from Morocco across North Africa into the Middle East and into the Caucasus Mountains. And they, of course, included Afghanistan, the Pashtuns there, and the Pashtuns of Pakistan and the Baloch. So we need to, by we, I mean America, American foreign policy, global policy, NATO, the European nations, they need to really devise a strategy to be able to deal with these societies, and in order to gently nudge them, move them into a world where they can begin to interact in a humane way within their own tradition with women, with minorities, and not put us in such a position that we turn a blind eye and we keep talking about terrorism and drugs and so on, which to the Afghans are not that important because they feel they can just deal with it or fudge the issue, and they're still, these issues are still there and everyone's fudging the issues. If you see, for example, the terrorism that has been inflicted on Pakistan by the TTP that's coming out of Afghanistan, then that's a clear sign that terrorism very much is alive and kicking in Afghanistan with the Taliban.
Thank you. Nipa Banerjee, do you think that Afghan women will have the patience and the survivability to wait for some recognition by the Taliban of having to deal in a more or less westernized manner in order to survive internationally?
Yes, I think that it is very much necessary. Both the speakers just before me, you know, they talked about this latest meeting between the U.S. and the Taliban, wherein the U.S. I read the report, and it says that the U.S. had U.S. has accepted, not accepted, I would say that U.S. has taken note, that was exactly the wording used, U.S. has taken note of the efforts made by the Taliban in the area of terrorism. I mean, there was no mention of getting out of the problem of terrorism and insecurity that it causes. But it also looked at the poppy cultivation, banning poppy cultivation. It is, well, as the speakers before me said, that at the meeting, reference to the Taliban ignoring or neglecting the rights of women, and also a violation of human rights, fundamental human rights of women, was virtually ignored. It was mentioned that that the U.S. condemns, or U.S. is concerned about the violation of human rights for women, but there was not much further discussion. What I think, because I have seen development programs and strategies for gender equality and women's development in different countries of the world, and I was particularly impressed with what Bangladesh has done with gender equality. I was posted in Bangladesh as a diplomat, as an aid representative, foreign aid representative for the government of Canada. And what I saw the women's condition was at that time, and when I go back now almost every year and I go and look at what has happened to the country in terms of development and especially women's issues, there's absolutely, I mean, you can't compare at all. The women now stand up in open public meetings, and they hold them in public spaces, open areas, And women stand up and they sort of talk to the village elders and say that you told us, you promised that you would have, you would give us these facilities, and we haven't received anything. Well, when are you going to do it now? And I have seen those village elders putting their heads down and not being able to answer the questions when the women, still leave a mark at the meeting. This has happened because of some of the strategies they used. And I compare Afghanistan's situation with Bangladesh, because both are Islamic countries, majority Muslim population. And acceptance of development strategies for women and gender equality, the models that are developed there can be followed by other Islamic countries, and especially Afghanistan. What in Bangladesh was emphasized was economic empowerment for women. And this was to be done, and it can relate directly to what the Taliban has done in Afghanistan, is that the women do not have to go out for work purposes. This excuse of things are not very secure, and so women should not be going out. Well, okay, rather than sort of battering the Taliban about, it is terrible, it's a cruelty to women, and there are other issues that are mentioned. Rather than doing that, to go to a situation where the women can practice business from home, and they do not have to go out, and they can practice business from home. That is, they do that in India. For tropical fruits are brought over to the women's home, and they are trained in the beginning for making condiments, jams, jellies, pickles. And when they are made, the male members of the family, they go out to the market to sell them, and the money comes back and given in the hands of the women. And when the women earn an income, they get confidence, and they get dignity. The family accepts women's work very easily because it's bringing additional funds to the family, and the community also accepts. This is only one. The similar things are done with education as well, but for some of these things, what will work better, I think, is to work with the religious bodies. For instance, the mullahs in a village, rather than critiquing Taliban all the time. You just have programming in place that will.
Thank you, Deepa. Thank you very much. Some of those points I'm sure we'll be coming back to. I want to turn to Minlib Dal at the moment to ask him to give us a perspective on what this means for Islam overall, for the Islamic community. There are many different, we understand there are many different sects of Islam, many, many. But how is Islam handling this extreme treatment of women in Afghanistan?
Well, before I do, I was going to pick up on what she was saying before. I say this. When I was called to do this, so I went to look at the numbers, right? Afghanistan and how the UNDP, for example, locate Afghanistan, right? Before I answer Islam. So Afghanistan has about 40 million people, right? 80% are rural dwellers that live in the rural part of the world, of about 75% of Afghans are about 35 years or younger, right? Afghanistan is located at 173 out of 178 countries. So Afghanistan is just above countries like Sierra Leone, Burkina Faso, Niger, and Burundi. If we take that and we look at Taliban vision of Islam, I think that's really what we're talking about. The Taliban are Deobandis. That's their origin, basically. They were all educated in that tradition. So for them, the ideal society resembled the society of Medina after the prophets, right? What they call the rightly guided period of the caliphate. This is their vision of the world. So their vision of the world is not what somebody called Western secular humanism. The previous speaker shows the difference between Bangladesh and Afghanistan under the Taliban, right? Now we're dealing with the Taliban. If we look across the board from Afghanistan, Iran, Saudi Arabia, Tunisia, and see how women's situation differ across the board, right? And the Taliban have a vision of Islam that is quite peculiar to them. And I don't, you know, so are we talking about the Taliban vision of Islam in which women are treated the way they are? Or are we talking about Islam as is understood across the globe? I don't think Indonesian women will identify with how Afghan are treating their women. So for me, we can't say this is what Islam says, or this is how people are, Islam proposes, or Islamic countries are proposing how we deal with women. I think we got to listen or pay attention to how the Taliban proposes, or at least understand their version of Islam.
Thank you. Of course, one difference with Bangladesh, and I think that Nipah's bringing up Bangladesh is interesting because it is relatively in the same region with Afghanistan. But in Bangladesh, there's a long tradition of women in politics. The leaders of both parties for so many years have been women, admittedly because their husbands were assassinated. But there were, and there, I believe there's a women's university in Bangladesh, which is a very strong symbol of respect for women's right to an education. Whether everything is in an ideal situation yet or not, I don't know. But there are at least some traditions in Bangladesh that go in the other direction. I want to turn for a moment to Arsala. Thank you very much for joining us on an impromptu basis, Arsala. And I'm interested in how you see the situation from the ground. As I understand it, you are based in the province very near the border of Afghanistan. And what do you have hope for a settling down of the situation in Afghanistan in such a way that women will be able to thrive again?
Thank you very much for inviting me. I hope you can hear me clearly now.
Yes, it's fine now.
Yeah. We have great hope. Hope is one way of surviving in the region. I would like the panelists to understand Afghanistan in a context of a country in modern times, for that matter, being in a war zone for over 40 years. Each of the but Taliban leaders that you see now have been, let's say, born in a third country, brought up in refugee camps under tremendous, tremendous conditions that one could not realize in the West. So you have to see them in that context. The whole society is traumatized by war or losing family or being affected in severe cases. I mean, look at the U.S. Army when they were there. They go for a tour of 6 months in one go, I guess. I don't know exactly, but that's what I heard. And they come back with such trauma of war. So you have to see Afghanistan as a victim over here in a sense of where they are and what they have been through. I can tell you with certainty that the present senior Taliban leadership are very much in tune to the Western values. They want to give education to the women in Afghanistan. But like the previous panelist said, the youth in the Taliban, which are the majority at the moment, they are the one who are more hardliners in this concept. And they are forcing the seniors not to give in. They say that we have fought this war for over 40 years. We've given blood, we've given sacrifices, and we cannot listen or be pushed by the West according to their version of life. So I think it is very important to give them space, I think, and to be fully engaged with them, which America's doing, and rightly. It is very important to not leave a vacuum. When the West leaves a vacuum, someone is going to fill it up. China just recently has had a very valuable commercial agreement in Afghanistan with, I think, copper mines or something like that. So vacuum or leaving Afghanistan to its own purpose would not be a way forward. Women, I can tell you jokingly, but with serious elements, that one of the Taliban leaders said, oh, we do this just to tease the West, because for them, this is sort of something that's their binoculars. They look through to Afghanistan through the women only. Whereas, you know, that's just one of the issues. And you have to keep the dialogue open in the sense that you talk about various issues. And for them, I think the other big issue is that, you know, our money has been stuck in America and they're not letting us give us our money. So fine, we can do what as we like. So they have a very strong, how would you say it, a view on this, that we fought the war, we won the war, and it's our right how to govern ourselves. So wrong or right, but the West has to engage, give them a little space, and try to, but like Professor Akbar said, it's a tribal society. And Pukhtuns, if you go in back into history, when the British were dealing with the Pukhtun tribes, you have to talk to them at par. You cannot talk to them as lower than you. That is a very big issue with the Pukhtun culture. You have to talk to them at also very in the local culture. So hope for the women, yes. Afghanistan in the 70s was Kabul was the Beirut of the Middle East. It was modern, young girls wearing skirts, going to school. It was the place to be. People used to drive from Peshawar in the 70s to Kabul for the weekends to have fun. So yes, it can be brought back to the level where it was. So with time, it will take time. It has to be a lot of patience, and one has to give them space and keep them engaged. It's very important. And it does affect the people in Pakistan across the border, because it's the same ethnic group. They're very connected by language, by religion. And that's the two very dominant forces in connection.
Thank you very much. Interesting perspective. I want to come back to you, Don, to ask how you react to that. Do you have, as an individual, this patience that people seem to be counseling as necessary? What about the individual victims in the meantime, I guess, is my reaction to it.
Well, yes. I mean, first of all, let me just say, of course, dialogue is important. There's no point in writing Afghanistan off and turning it into a North Korea, for example. But I do take issue with some of the points that our colleague Akbar and Arsala have made, as though somehow being a tribal culture justifies the total lack of respect, I'm sorry, for 50% of the population, that it's turned women, as it stands now, as simply an instrument for bearing children. The issue of education, which of course in Islam is very important, the removal of women from high school, from university, from employment, these just cannot be ignored because it's a tribal society. I mean, as you mentioned, Arsala, Pakistan also has a very large Pashtun population. It has also a tribal society. Saudi Arabia, which is not a really good example in terms of human rights, but just in terms of the right of women to be educated, the right of women to work, is also a deeply tribal society. So I think, I do take issue to the suffering of 50% of the population, women, not able to seek to be educated, not able to work, not able to even have their hair cut or their nails manicured. I'm sure there are plenty of barber shops throughout Afghanistan that make sure that men have their beards properly cut, et cetera, et cetera. So many of these rules, I don't believe are to tease the West. I do believe it has to do with I think right now he's the senior, the mullah, considers his interpretation of Hanafi Islam, correct. And this is why he's so coming down on the rights of women. This isn't to say that men's rights aren't also being deeply repressed as well. So I don't think it's about tribalism. I think really Pakistan, and I'd love to hear the reaction, Arsala. I think Pakistan is much implicated in the way the Taliban are behaving and are negotiating with the West in terms of what can we get away with. Okay, there's 7 billion that's being held, but it does seem to me that economic stability is at this point maybe not being as deeply affected by the sanctions that are in place, but there may be worse to come. So the need for negotiation, for finding a way of providing stability, but also recognizing human rights. I mean, I think the Taliban are quite interested in being recognized internationally. At this point, I think no country is recognizing the Taliban. But to be recognized internationally also means adhering to the numerous international treaties that respect human rights, that respect the state's treatment of women, of children. And at this point, I don't think the Taliban is really interested or ready to consider signing on to these agreements, or perhaps it might sign on but not respect them. So it's really important to keep a discussion, but then of course everybody's got to have a carrot and a stick. These discussions have to continue, but I do think that it's not about tribalism. It's about the fact that at this point in time, Afghanistan does not have a shura. You know what I mean? It is not respecting the way tribal societies function throughout Saudi Arabia, throughout the Emirates. Tribal societies have councils of elders who work. And in Arabic, we call it the shura. And I'm sure there's a similar term in Dari, but there is no shura.
It's called Jirgas.
Yes, and that isn't working, because if it were, I think you would find that some of these extreme rules would not be put into place.
Thank you, Don, very much for that perspective. I'm going to come back to Ambassador Ahmed, but I can ask people to try to speak briefly. We have about another 10, 15 minutes before we go back to Mike Scott and to take some participants' questions. So, Professor Ahmed.
Yes, some fascinating issues have arisen. We've had the comparison with Bangladesh and Afghanistan, and of course, those are two very different societies, as any anthropologist worth his salt will mention. Very different societies, very different aspirations of people. And ultimately, I was the one who, in fact, pointed to the plight of women. And Dawn seems to have said that she wants to take issue with the role of women, assuming there's an assumption that somehow we weren't aware of that. If you read anything I've written, you'll understand that the role of women and the treatment of women and the treatment of knowledge or the lack of respect for people, of the learned people and of minorities, has been central to my analysis of Afghanistan and other such societies. You cannot escape the two. And that leads us to an interpretation of Islam. The Taliban, as Menlevs has very rightly pointed out, have one version of Islam. And that then, if you follow that logic, then they are going to treat and mistreat women in this way and minorities in this way. So really, in some senses, they have to begin to open up their understanding of Islam through learning, through scholarship, through conferences. And here, scholars from the rest of the Muslim world can help a great deal. And I think it's very important for Western scholars to also understand this. And this sort of neo-imperialist attitude that the carrot and the stick, those days are over. No one in the third world is accepting that anymore. And they're not prepared to accept this. You come along and say, we'll give you a kick or we'll give you a carrot and you listen to us. And the Afghans are very conscious of this. They have defeated several superpowers in the past. They've defeated the Soviets, they've defeated the British. And they believe, rightly or wrongly, they believe that they have defeated the Americans now. So I don't think anyone turning up with a bowler hat and a walking stick and saying that we'll give you a kick in the pants or give you some sweets in order for you to listen to us is going to get very far. You have to convince them, you have to deal with them, because there's the reality of geopolitics. And that means the reality of China sitting there, Russia sitting there, India sitting there, all these great powers in the region, making it an attempt to win them over. And how we are treating the Afghans, almost as if time has stood still and not changed. The times have changed very dramatically, and we need to accept that. We can't be out of touch with the times and behave like Miss Havisham in Great Expectations.
Thank you. I'd like to go back. And first of all, let me say that if other people, other participants in the program have questions, this would be a good time to put them into the Q&A button before Mike Scott sorts them out and raises them with the panel. Why don't I go back to Nipa and Minlib briefly to ask how you respond to these perspectives. One of the things that strikes me, and maybe you could both address this, is that we're not really getting very much information out of Afghanistan these days. It does seem to have been relegated to yesterday's news. Of course, there's so very many international crises at once, and some countries are having, including our own, just extraordinary circuses in their own politics. So what's the path to getting some really constructive improvement in the situation in Afghanistan around the world? Nipa, do you have a few words on that?
If you can give me the precise question. Okay. You've given the background.
Right. Well, what is it we should be, where should the focus be now if there's going to be some hope for Afghanistan and for its women in particular?
I think that the different countries have, no country has recognized the Taliban, which I'm not quibbling with. I mean, it is correct that they cannot be recognized right away, but the different countries that the different countries are meeting with the Taliban, to me, is a hopeful sign. I very strongly believe that not engaging with the Taliban would be a good strategy, because it does not help the ordinary people and also women. You know, if we continued with our sanctions, if we continue with the restrictions on women, it's not going to help anything. It will not really, I mean, our actions this way will not help the women's rights to be promoted. So we need to look at practical strategies that can be done. And I mentioned that, and one of the things I mentioned was getting economic empowerment to women, might really change the mind of the Taliban, because it is going to help the families, it will help the communities, it will also help their own legitimacy with the people. And similarly, education, for instance, it is going to go the same way. That it's going to, and I am not so sure that we are arguing or we are engaging with the Taliban, talking about these things and even providing models. I mean, I do understand that Bangladesh and Afghanistan are different, but the strategies I propose will not really have any political implications. It will be the strategies I propose will have nothing to do with how Taliban have suppressed the women. We will just talk about how we can help the women. We, in the sense, not only Western powers, but even the Arab countries, the Gulf Cooperation Council, etc.
Thank you. Minda, what do you say about that? What do you think is?
Definitely. I want to say though that the lady who was criticizing the fact that some of us insist on the fact to understand what kind of society we're dealing with, right? This society is traditional. This society is religiously oriented, right? Tribal structures are still the operating structure of the society. I think if we want to reach them, that has to be taken into account. I come from a community where, elders count, religious leaders count. So if we want to reach them, we do need to take seriously their vision of the world. Take it seriously, then we can talk to them and keep that in mind. I want to add that in terms of those who are dealing with the new 2021 return of the Taliban, it seems to me we're making almost the same mistake when they came to power in 1996. It's like nobody wanted to recognize them, da, 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 da. But until 2001 when the collapse. But what I want to say on that, there are three group of folks that are around Afghanistan since 2001. Of course, USA and the European Union. That's one group. The other group is the border countries of Afghanistan, particularly Iran, Pakistan, and China. That's a different group. The third group that I identify is Turkey, India, and Russia. They don't have borders with Afghanistan directly, but they play a role. Those three groups of countries need to be talking to Afghans in a manner that the Taliban will feel that they are recognized. If we keep insisting we won't recognize them, we will go back to 1996. We'll be making the same mistake. I think it's time to take them seriously. Then I have a conversation with them and see that it's no longer 1996. Somebody said it's the younger group among the Taliban who are the most conservative, right? So unless, in my view, we take all that into account, instead of coming in, like the anthropologist was saying, Until we're coming in and saying, all right, this is our Western secular values of humanism. You got to get into it. Well, I don't think it will work. Those guys feel that they won the war. So they should sit at the same table with the same privilege as folks in, who are talking to them. It's my Thank view. That, yeah.
I'm going to say we need to go turn things back over to Mike now. There are quite a few questions that came in the Q&A button. And I need to remind Mike that I at least must finish promptly at quarter past the hour today because of some other business that we need to take care of. So Mike, over to you to handle the second part here of the discussion.
Thank you very much. It's obviously a very, very deep subject that we're talking about, and a very complex subject related to cultures. Some of the questions that have come in are exactly on that. This is Esther. She says, it seems like there is a lot of learning for the West and Afghanistan to learn about each other and cultural values, differences, and develop respect and understanding. Is this deemed as a realistic possibility in the future? And how can this be achieved without any intervening country having an ulterior motive or being looked at with suspicion by Afghanistan or others? That's a terrific, terrific question, Esther, that I think our panels have been talking around a little bit already. I wonder, Dawn, whether you might like to come in on that one first.
Yes, I mean, obviously, it's important to recognize the cultural values of the Taliban. If they represent the cultural values of all Afghan, which I think what we're looking at is perhaps cultural values in the extreme of 30 to 35% of the population, very much as what we have in the United States with supporters of Donald Trump. Obviously, for any kind of negotiations, both sides have to have an understanding of their position. But I don't think the fact that the Taliban did not enter into negotiation with the government of Afghanistan, or rather, I should say, the government of Afghanistan fled, so there was no negotiation that took place, means that therefore the Taliban come to a negotiating party as the winners. The winners of what? You know, in the end, it's about recognition and power. That's what international relations are about. So if the Taliban are interested in sanctions being lifted, in it being recognized as a country by the rest of the world, by the United Nations, their standing is tied Afghanistan negotiated and reconsidered. And we already know that in the West, there is extreme concern for the lack of human rights in general, but particularly for the withdrawal of the rights of women to be educated and to work, for example. You know, whether or not they can listen to music or they can walk on the street without an accompanying male, these are part of the culture and part of traditions. But there are some basic human rights that the Taliban, if they want international recognition, need to sit down and recognize they might have to do some compromising about. That's you know, because in the end, the power lies outside of Afghanistan. So it's the states outside of Afghanistan who do have a carrot. And I'm sorry, Akbar, I thought that you were mocking me in your earlier intervention. But carrot and stick is about, you know, if the state wants to be recognized, then it's going to have to go along with some kind of compromises. And I think whether that's called realpolitik or something else, I mean, I think it's an obvious. There has to be a recognition of what the West or the nations of the United Nations would like to see, and the Afghan are going to have to recognize they can go it alone like North Korea, but if they want recognition, there has to be some compromise. And maybe that would mean some compromises then result in some lifting of sanctions, a greater humanitarian aid coming into the country. I think, I don't know the exact figure, but humanitarian assistance is very, very badly needed. At least that's what reports tell us. So it's sitting down together and recognizing that the Taliban also need to consider compromising, whether they won the internal war in Afghanistan doesn't really put them in a position where they can demand to be recognized outside of their country without recognizing what demands from outside in terms of human rights are being very, very strongly argued for.
Akbar, do you want to say something about this?
Yes.
Thank you, Don.
First of all, Don, I am sorry if you thought I was mocking you. I was just pointing out that after 200 years, no one in that part of the world appreciates people coming in from the West, waving about either a carrot or a sword and forcing them to change their customs of views or values as dictated from the West. I think it's critical we understand that. And in order for that to happen, scholars like you need to interpret both to each other in their own terms. That is the basic premise of anthropology, which you are studying. In fact, the latest issue in the Royal Anthropological Institute of Anthropology today has an article by me on precisely this subject, because this is a subject which is very ongoing and of great concern to us anthropologists. Now, with your indulgence, Michael, I think I'd like to ask Ursula about the Taliban and the Afghan Taliban. He mentioned the young Taliban versus the older Taliban, and to see why there's such a difference and how they could, one way or the other, be players in this understanding of relations between the West and the Taliban.
Yes, that's a good point, because we had a question in that says, what do the Taliban seek, if anything, from the West?
Yes. Ursula?
Should I say? Yes, you go first, Ursula, and then Midland.
Okay. The younger Taliban, I want to repeat that they feel as victors, and no, could be wrong, could be anything. Yes, it's internal or external. Throughout human history, victors have been victors. They dictate their terms, unfortunately. I've always, I mean, the Pukhtun or the Islam, both have equal rights for women. Islam, 1400 years ago, they gave rights to women, whereas the West Cambridge, only in 1930s, the girls, women got their rights to get degrees or something. So there is absolutely no thought in my mind that women should not be educated. Women should be educated 100%. There is no doubt in that. And majority of the Pukhtuns would think that way. Unfortunately, the young Talibans are far in majority. They push the older Taliban to follow this extreme method, either to tease the West or to get publicity. And if we increase the horizon of argument or discussion of women plus other things, we cannot just stick to just the point that women don't have right. I agree, it's wrong. 100% it's wrong. It's unfair. It's inhuman. It's un-Islamic even. But at this moment, they have the government. They are in control. That's the fact, reality. No matter what the West does, you say you don't recognize them, but the Chinese are talking to them. The Indians are talking to them. The Saudis are talking to them. The UAE is talking to them. America is talking to them. What sort of recognitions do they need beyond this? All the countries are indirectly recognizing them, but yes, officially there's no recognition. But again, my point would be, or the way forward would be, is space, time, and increase the dialogue just from one point agenda to larger agendas, bigger agendas, where you can talk on other either way, on women's, on economic, health, education, and other issues, human development.
Mainly.
Oh, sure. I'm just going to say that when I was working on this, I watched Al Jazeera documentary on Zahid Bula, I think that's his name, Majid. He's like the spokesperson, the new spokesperson of the Taliban. And then you do see that when you listen to, you know, what there is, it's not that those guys want to be isolated and not be talked to, you know, they do. But they want to do it in such a way that their constituency, right, their constituency is their primary axe, right? This guy, he's like the go-between, the supreme leader and everybody else. And then when you watch the documentary, you see women doctors who are dealing with women in the rural side will come and voice, you know, women education, women return to job and all that. But that is, according to him, he will transport that to the supreme leader and the supreme leader will make a decision. Right, that is, so I think, like the previous person was saying, we do need first and foremost to pay attention to where they are. I want to say that 1996 to 2001, they were kicked out. 20 years later, they come back. There is something about the Taliban capacity to win war and return to power that we must respect. That is my position. Then you don't engage in a negotiation or talk without, you know, giving something up. But I think that, like the lady was saying, I agree with her. The international community will have its demands. The Taliban will come, at least they are in power for the moment. They will come also seeking something. And it is in that negotiation that something will move. That's the way I see it. It's in that negotiation, we got to take them seriously and understand their worldview. And then say, okay, this is the international community. This is not the first time we're dealing with complicated societies. But so I believe that it is in that. It was, I mean, I'll conclude on this one by saying that United States did not include Karzai or Hani's government into their discussion in Doha with the Afghanistan, with the Taliban. There was a lesson there to learn. Right? Why? Because the Taliban knew that it wasn't about Ashraf Ghani or Karzai. It was about the United States. The United States also knew that it wasn't about anybody else. It was about the Taliban. That's the people that they talk to. So I think we can learn and say, all right, those are the forces in place. Let's talk and see where we can go from here by taking each one seriously on their basis.
Okay. Kyle Hawkes puts another issue into the pot, really. I mean, we talked about it, but into the pot of what you've just been talking about now, and I'll come to Akbar on this. Given Afghanistan's tribal nature and history of political conflict and lack of a unified single government, do you think that the Taliban will be successful in maintaining control of the entire country in the long term?
Akbar. Michael, this is a very important question and issue in terms of Afghanistan. And again, this is characteristic of tribal society. And this is called, in fact, there's a term for it, agnatic rivalry. So there's very sharp rivalry between the father's brother's son and the ego, the individual. So Afghanistan reflects this very intense internal rivalry, which means that the history of Afghanistan is constantly cousins fighting each other at all costs, meaning that they would destroy their own position simply to uphold this particular principle of tribal society. And there comes a time when, if you recall, early in the 19th century, one of the kings of Afghanistan escaped from Kabul and arrived at Peshawar, which was then under the British, and said, I would rather be a grass cutter in the British camp than the king of Afghanistan, because this intense internal rivalry will not let them rest in peace. And what I'm worried about really is that unless there's a strong man who emerges and unites Afghanistan, unless there's some charismatic religious figure or political figure or royal figure, unless that happens, this internal division and pull will not go away. And with the powers in the region all fishing in troubled waters, and we've already named, Min has just given you a whole list of foreign powers interested in Afghanistan, that means that there will be foreign powers stoking these internal rivalries, and you are not going to see any calm and peace in the coming time. There will be constant tensions, constant turmoil, and that is why you need a much, much more sophisticated, wise understanding of how to deal with Afghanistan, and not this kind of, you go charging in and try to kick them and humiliate them, etc. We've seen the results of that. So you need to have developed a strategy of mature officers, particularly officers dealing with them, because it has to be the long term. And if that doesn't happen, you're going to get other powers in the region, especially the Chinese, the Indians, the Russians, all very actively keeping their foot in the door.
Thank you for that. I'm going to come to a last question, which I'm going to give to each of you. But please answer, you know, one or two sentences, because we're getting out of time. And this has come from Caroline. Since we're exploring human rights through pathways of policy and dialogue with native tribal elders, please can you suggest specific strategies and practical recommendations for humanitarian diplomats to implement on the field while adhering to bridge the gap between the Western agendas of human rights and the Taliban's Islamic ideology and cultural perspective? What I think Caroline's asking is there an answer? Is there an answer without having suspicion on one side or the other? Is there a way of doing that? And I know history's causing problems. Western cultural imperialism causing problems. The tribal issues within the country cause problems. The relationship between those ruling the country and the religious factions is causing problems. You've told us all about that. But I think what Caroline is asking for is, quite simply, not a long speech about this, but quite simply, is there something that can be done by the West? Is there? Dawn.
Well, it's a tough one, partially because I think the original, you know, Doha deal when Trump was president didn't ask the Taliban for anything, but gave them an awful lot in return. So there isn't really a very good model to go by. I think in the end, there needs to be a step-by-step approach. For example, I think I had read somewhere that either the UNICEF or WFP was considering just trying to have more access, trying to come into the country, whether or not the Taliban would permit that. I think they were trying to have, they were raising the issue about women and working and somehow tying it into bringing in more humanitarian aid. I mean, if this can be done sitting around the table step by step, perhaps that is one step. I mean, obviously, I'm sure the Taliban are aware that they do need a lot more international humanitarian assistance for the population that is really suffering. And
I'm going to stop you there.
Yep.
I think you've given us one solution step by step. Nipa, what do you think? Is it a step by step approach?
I think the step-by-step approach will be very useful. I would say that the Taliban and all powers, like, you know, Western powers, as well as Gulf Cooperation Council, all of these countries could get together and they could establish a roadmap as to how to proceed step by step with milestones established and with, like, you know, a carrot and stick approach was talked about before, and how to provide or deliver both parties, like Afghanistan as well, the Taliban, as well as the other countries that are getting together. They have to agree with the milestones established with dates and concrete deliverables. And once, and this should be step-by-step approach. And then they can after the delivery, as the Taliban delivers, the other countries will also deliver. Say, for instance, removal of one sanction. I'm just giving an instance, but could this be considered?
Okay. Thanks. Thank you for that. Asala, step-by-step, roadmap? Is this the solution?
Absolutely. Sorry? Step-by-step. Roadmap over here, it reminds me of a story, a book called Three Cups of Tea by an American in the mountains, and he almost 50. So his concept was three cups of tea. The first cup, the village head told him, is a guest. You come in, we give you a cup of tea. Second is to, cup of tea would be to get to know you, each other, and the third cup of tea is to befriend each other. And that's when you can be effective in this region.
Right. Okay. Thank you. Minlim.
Well, I got to agree with what was already said. I think she's associated with Georgetown, who said that, we got to weigh, poverty versus security. Control of opium versus what the Afghan want. I think for me, this is what the Afghan have their list. The international community has their list. They got to come and present so that each party will identify what, because the step by step is good, but we do need to agree on what is the first step, what is the second step, the roadmap. We do need to agree on what the roadmap is, what are the milestones that we have to reach. I think that's where the result will come, because it's not guaranteed that we have the same goals, right? So some people want security, some people want to end poverty, and so on, right? So that's what I'll add.
Of course, and that goes back to the argument years ago about the Soviet Union and the West, and talking about détente. The Soviet Union thought of it, translated in one way, and the West translated it in another way. So you've got to get that sorted out. You've got to get the language right. Okay, Minlim. Akbar.
Thank you, Michael. Well, first of all, Michael, I would like to congratulate the organizers of this session. I think what is crucial is that we continue to talk about Afghanistan, to highlight Afghanistan, what needs to be done there, point to the problems, point to where we could be moving ahead, and not to speak down to them with condescension. We know they've done terrible things. That has to be taken on board, because without that, you're not going to move ahead. There are ways of doing this, and you heard Min, you heard Arsala, they were dealing with these people, and they're able to penetrate beneath the surface and give us some very concrete proposals. Without this, Afghanistan will slide over the brink, and I pointed this out, it's at the center of a very important geopolitical location, which will drag in other people, and once again drag us in the United States into Afghanistan in that cockpit, really. And in order to allow America to play a positive role, which it must, because America is the one country that can promote democracy, human rights, all these great values that come from the vision of the founding fathers. And that can only happen if America is able to play a role. And if the door is closed. It will not be able to play that role, and it would have lost this round. And there is, at this moment, no guarantee that it's going to win that particular round. So I want to really thank all members of the panel, very distinguished members of the panel, delighted to meet them, interact with them, and I hope we continue to interact with each one of you. Dawn, by the way, I'm speaking in Oxford, and I'll tell you about it when I get your email. I hope we'll be able to speak through that session. And thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Well, that's a good moment for me to say we're going to wind up now. And I'm going to hand over first to Sandy before I wind up the whole of the...
Right. Thanks very much, everyone. I think this was a fascinating and a good, candid discussion, which I think is needed around problems like this. And I just want to very concisely thank, as usual, Georgetown University for its support of these programs and the partnership that Mike and I have charted over nearly 3 years now. One last thing I want to say is for those of our participants who live in Minnesota or the upper Midwest, to look out for our symposium on free speech that's coming on the 18th to the 20th of September in St. Paul, a very important discussion of First Amendment free speech, free expression issues. Back to you, Mike.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Sandy, as ever. And my thanks also, of course, to all the members of the panel. It's been a fascinating afternoon, and I know I've learned a great deal from this, and I'm sure we've had a very good audience, and I'm sure that that's the case. Can I thank the people who've actually put in very, very good questions today as well?
Michael, could we thank John McCabe? He's been very helpful and very involved in coordinating. Thank you, John.
I was just about to do it, Akbar. Well done. I'd like to thank all at Georgetown, including John McCabe, our administrator. I'd like to thank the people also in Oxford who've helped us, particularly Maggie Scott, who works for me, as well as being my wife, I'm afraid, at Oxford Scott Education Limited. So I thank her for her administration. I'd like to thank people at Campion Hall, including Nick Austin, and at Blackfriars Hall. Nick Austin is the master of Campion Hall. At Blackfriars Hall, to John O'Connor, the regent, and Richard Finn, the director of the Las Casas Institute. And a welcome at Blackfriars, Nick Crow, who's the new prior at Blackfriars, and is very interested that we should continue these kind of discussions. So I thank him in advance for working with him in the future. And talking of the future, on the 13th of September, we're going to return to Ukraine and Russia. Where do we go to from here? That's the 13th of September. On the 11th of October, we're going to have a look at the current American spectacle, international perspectives. What are people making of America now and all that is going on? So we're looking at the panels for that. So two good things coming up in the fall, or in the autumn, as we say in the UK. On Tuesday, the 26th of September, for those of you who are in the Washington area, there is a public event in the Riggs Library at Georgetown University on the future of the humanities. And remember, this Future of the Humanities project is one of the two projects that join for these sessions. And that will include on the panel, which I'm chairing, but on the panel, colleagues from Blackfriars Hall and from Georgetown University to discuss that important issue. Where are we going with the humanities? Where are we going with humanity? Thank you all for listening. Thank you again to the panel. Thank you.